From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Review podcast. I am Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I'm here today with Dr. Toby Maher to discuss his recently published review on interstitial lung disease. Dr. Maher is Professor of Medicine and Director of Interstitial Lung Diseases at the University of Southern California. Welcome, Dr. Maher, and thank you so much for being here today.
Pleasure. Thank you very much for the invitation.
Let's start by having you define for us what are interstitial lung diseases.
So the term interstitial lung disease, or ILD, is really an umbrella term that is used to describe several hundred conditions that can affect the interstitial space within the lung. And the interstitial space within the lung is essentially the region of the wall of the alveolus that is bounded on one side by the epithelium and on the other side by capillary endothelium, and which in health normally contains a few structural fibroblasts, but otherwise represents a potential space. And interstitial lung diseases are conditions which can cause inflammation and or fibrosis within that interstitial space.
How common are these diseases overall? And also, what are the most common types?
So as individual entities, each one of the interstitial lung diseases is relatively rare, but in combination, they form a huge problem, really. So in the United States, for instance, there are over 650,000 people living with some form of interstitial lung disease. And under that umbrella, the most common ones that we see are idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, hypersensitivity pneumonitis, and also interstitial lung disease arising in the context of systemic autoimmune diseases, such as rheumatoid arthritis and systemic sclerosis.
So who's at risk for interstitial lung disease?
So for the first two that I just mentioned, idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis and hypersensitivity pneumonitis, the risk tends to increase with age. So classically, people who develop these forms of ILD will be in their 60s or 70s. Idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is commoner in male patients, we think, because of industrial exposures to things that cause injury to the lung, and also because of past smoking patterns. Hypersensitivity pneumonitis tends to affect people who have exposures to certain organic antigens, such as mold and birds. So it is seen in particular groups who are at risk of those exposures. And then the autoimmune diseases themselves, so rheumatoid arthritis, systemic sclerosis, myositis, all of those are associated with a risk of ILD of between 10 to 50%. So individuals with autoimmune disease are automatically at increased risk of ILD.
So you mentioned that idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis was one of the more common forms of interstitial lung disease, but your review discusses that really any interstitial lung disease can evolve into pulmonary fibrosis. Could you talk about that?
As you've alluded to in the question, an idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis really is the sort of the archetypal fibrotic lung disease. The disease, even in its earliest stage, seems to begin with fibrosis that gets inexorably worse. However, many of the other interstitial lung diseases actually begin with an inflammatory insult. And so the autoimmune diseases would be a good example. The initial insult is an immune-mediated injury to the lung, which in some cases, if treated early enough, can seemingly respond to immunomodulatory therapy. But if that opportunity is missed, these conditions can progress from sort of chronic inflammatory damage through to fibrosis. And with many of these diseases, there seems to be a tipping point that once enough fibrosis has developed, that in itself becomes self-perpetuating. So although, for instance, scleroderma and idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis are very distinct and separate disorders, towards the end stages of both diseases, they ultimately affect the lung in a very similar way, and result in a very similar level of morbidity and mortality.
What are the typical presenting symptoms of interstitial lung disease?
So the typical symptoms are often very subtle to begin with, which is one of the challenges in diagnosing interstitial lung disease. So typically, the interstitial lung disease will impair oxygen absorption from the alveolus into the blood within the alveolar capillaries. And so the symptoms relate to that. And the very earliest symptom is exertional breathlessness, which to begin with can be very subtle. But as the disease becomes more severe, then the level of dyspnea and exercise limitation will increase to the point that patients with severe disease will have resting respiratory failure. But like I say, at the earliest stages, it tends just to be subtle exertional breathlessness. Some patients also have a cough. Often we diagnose patients a little bit earlier when they have a cough because that symptom tends to be more intrusive and is more easily noticed by patients or their loved ones.
And what physical exam findings are typical at the time of diagnosis?
So for interstitial lung diseases alone, the sort of the very classic clinical finding is the bilateral basal Velcro-like crepitations. And those can often be heard in patients with very early disease. So as pulmonologists, we certainly encourage careful clinical examination of any patient presenting with exertional breathlessness because those bilateral basal crepitations can be the earliest and most important clue to a diagnosis of ILD. Beyond that, a proportion of patients will have finger clubbing. And then we've mentioned the association with autoimmune disease. So sometimes we will see features of connective tissue disease, so skin thickening in scleroderma, the changes of Raynaud's phenomenon. In patients with myositis, for instance, we'll often see Gottlieb's papules and mechanics hands. Or in patients with rheumatoid arthritis, you might see arthralgia and arthropathy affecting the small joints of the hand.
Given that the presenting symptoms that you mentioned are pretty nonspecific, shortness of breath on exertion, cough, when should the primary care clinician think about interstitial lung disease as a possible diagnosis?
Yeah, so there clearly is a challenge for primary care physicians. And if you imagine, as I've just told you, the average patient is in their 60s. So you have a 60-year-old patient who's a former smoker who comes to you complaining of mild exertional breathlessness. The obvious differential diagnoses would include cardiovascular disease, COPD, and then probably further down that list, interstitial lung disease. And so distinguishing ILD from the more common causes of exertional breathlessness in that age group can be difficult. I think one of the key clues in the history is the rapidity of onset of the symptoms. So patients with COPD will tend to have much slower onset of breathlessness over many years, whereas ILD patients will have noticed a change over a period, usually of a few months. And then the thing that often distinguishes it from things like cardiovascular disease or asthma is the consistency of the symptom. The patient will very much notice exercise limitation at a certain level of exertion, and they tend to have stable symptoms day to day. There doesn't tend to be so much variability. And then, as I've said, the clinical finding of the bilateral basal crepitations should really be the red flag that alerts people to the possibility that this is an actual ILD that's causing the symptoms rather than something else.
And when interstitial lung disease is suspected as a possible diagnosis, what should the generalist start with regard to diagnostic testing?
Yeah, so I think if there is a suspicion, then obviously one is going to go to simple investigations to start with, and spirometry and chest X-ray can be helpful in that regard. So in the majority of patients with ILD, chest X-ray will show some abnormalities. So in IPF, for instance, you would expect to see bilateral basal reticular change on a chest X-ray. Similarly, with spirometry, you would expect to see some evidence of airflow restriction. That said, neither test alone has high sensitivity or specificity, particularly for early disease, and it is possible to miss early cases. And really, the definitive diagnostic test for identifying ILD is the CT scan.
What type of CT scan?
So and classically, people have referred to the CT scan we do as high-resolution CT. That's a slightly out-of-date term that refers to the technique that was used on old scanners about 20 years ago. But nowadays, any volumetric thoracic CT will ultimately give you the level of resolution you need for the lungs to be able to see even an early interstitial lung disease. So as long as you ask your radiologist for a thoracic CT because you suspect ILD, you can use the terminology high-resolution CT. Either should work to provide you a high-quality volumetric CT of the lungs.
Let's turn to therapy. What is first-line therapy for interstitial lung disease?
As we've said, the interstitial lung diseases are a broad range of conditions, and so there isn't one single treatment for all forms of interstitial lung disease. Had we been having this discussion 10 years ago, then we wouldn't really have had any treatments to talk about, but thankfully we have seen some development over that period of time. So for idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, we have antifibrotic drugs. So there are two drugs, pirfenidone and nintedanib, which work to slow the rate at which fibrosis progresses. And so those tend to be the first line treatment for idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. For more immune-mediated or inflammatory diseases, and scleroderma-related ILD is the best example of these because that's the disease in which most clinical trials have been performed. We know that immunomodulatory therapy with things like tocilizumab, mycophenolate mofetil, cyclophosphamide, rituximab can have an impact on disease trajectory and can even in the short term improve lung function. And then we know that for those patients who develop pulmonary fibrosis in the context of their interstitial lung disease, that the use of the antifibrotic drug nintedanib can again help to slow disease progression. So those are our medical options. In terms of non-medical options, we know that exercise-based therapy is effective for patients in terms of improving symptoms and exercise capacity. So we'll typically refer patients for pulmonary rehabilitation, which is a course that encapsulates both a teaching component to educate patients about their disease, but also an important exercise-based component where patients do physical training to try and improve their exercise capacity. And then for patients who end up with end-stage disease, we can use oxygen. So we'll typically prescribe oxygen for patients to use on exertion if they have evidence of desaturation below 88% on a walk test. And we can show that we can correct that desaturation and reduce their breathlessness with ambulatory oxygen. And then for patients with resting respiratory failure, so oxygen saturations below 88% at rest, we will tend to prescribe 24-hour-a-day oxygen. And then our sort of go-to treatment for patients who have continued to worsen despite all available therapies is lung transplant. Lung transplant can be a transformational treatment for patients. We can take them from respiratory failure back to leading a normal life. The downside of transplant is, firstly, the availability of organs is very low, and so it's probably less than 1% of our patients will ultimately be transplanted. And furthermore, transplants associated with a need for being on lifelong immunosuppression and is also associated with a range of complications, including the ever-present risk of rejection and also infection. So it's an imperfect treatment, but it can be very important for patients with end-stage disease. And then obviously, with many of these diseases progressing to respiratory failure and death, there is an important role for managing symptoms, both breathlessness and cough. And also, together with palliative care, we work very hard to manage end-of-life decision-making and ensure management of symptoms at end-of-life for patients as these diseases reach their terminal phases.
So I have a few questions for you about the treatments. First, how effective are the drugs that you mentioned?
The antifibrotic drugs, pirfenidone and nintedanib, were shown in clinical trials to approximately halve the rate at which idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis progresses. So the average patient loses about 240 milliliters of FVC a year, and that's approximately halved with treatment. When the drug was approved by the FDA made it clear that their opinion was that slowing FVC decline would ultimately lead to improved survival. And subsequent real-world registries have suggested that treatment with antifibrotic drugs is associated with an improvement in life expectancy from about 3.5 years in untreated patients to a life expectancy of about 5 years from diagnosis in patients treated with antifibrotic drugs. So we have seen this improvement in life expectancy with treatment, but we've still got a very long way to go before we can effectively prevent fibrotic disease from getting worse. Treatment in scleroderma ILD, where we have more options and we can use immunomodulatory drugs, is probably more effective. Certainly in trials of 12 months duration, we've been successful in preventing disease decline. And with some of these immunomodulatory drugs, have even seen modest improvements in lung function. We don't have so much long-term data to be able to say what impact that has had on survival. Although when you look at survival in the autoimmune diseases and particularly scleroderma overall, there has been an improvement in life expectancy for patients with these conditions over the last decade or so. So I think the drugs do make a difference, but we're a long way from preventing, let alone curing, ILD in these conditions.
And can you comment on whether the oxygen and the exercise therapy are mainly to improve symptoms, or do they have any disease-modifying effects?
That's a very good question, and I don't have a complete answer for you. So the evidence we have really points to them improving symptoms and quality of life for patients. We suspect that that may well be associated with life expectancy benefits with pulmonary rehab, but we don't have the evidence to support that. And similarly with oxygen, we believe, at least theoretically, that the early use of oxygen might help prevent the development of complications such as pulmonary hypertension. But again, we don't have the evidence to truly prove that we are doing that with oxygen therapy.
Thanks. This has been a very informative discussion. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
I think we've covered a lot in a very short period of time. I know I would just emphasize to listeners that interstitial lung disease is undoubtedly more common than they've realized. Almost all of the ILDs are life-shortening and have very important implications for our patients. And I really think being alert to the possibility of interstitial lung disease when you see a breathless patient is important, because early diagnosis allows earlier treatment, which in turn almost certainly will help improve outcomes and life expectancy for patients with these otherwise very life-threatening diseases.
This is Mary McDermott, Deputy Editor of JAMA, and I've been speaking today with Dr. Toby Maher on his JAMA review about interstitial lung diseases. For more of our podcasts, please visit us at jamanetworkaudio.com. You can subscribe and listen wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.